Great honor being here. This is a picture I took from the balcony of my apartment on a rainy day. And the reason I put that there is because it's pretty much resume the gloomy feeling I have since I entered this topic of research. Essentially, there's still stigma, there's still people not understanding, the drugs are not great, the companies are moving out, there are personal tragedies. Yeah, so. However, if I change the lens on the camera, I see that. And this is where I work. And I don't know if you can see, but this is actually a 1930-era lunatic asylum that used to host 5,000 inpatients. 5,000 inpatients on a population of less than a million. And when I go to work to that, which is a lab where we're doing research on trying to understand how drugs may work. Where are the 5,000 patients now? We have come a long way. We have come from nothing to something, and if we have come that way, I'm reminded every day that we can come farther. And the way we're trying to address that in the lab is by trying to see how we came where we are and how we can go farther by trying to reverse engineer something that works and that is one of the most efficient drugs still prescribed in psychiatry. So how we got there? But pretty much in contrast to what we try to do now, we got lucky. And we got tremendously lucky over a very short period of time. So essentially, pretty much what all the prescribed drugs of today are coming from therapeutic principles that were discovered by Serendipity in the 1950s. Antipsychotics, 1950s, we found a rationale for that in the 1970s. Same thing for antidepressants. So essentially what I was saying is that we went there to get antidepressants, antipsychotics, by luck. We understood about 30 years after we found them, how they work. Other classes of drugs, stimulants, I guess we can thank the Incas for that. The anxiolytics, same stories. So for all these drugs, we found mechanism through which they work or partially work. And that leaves us with one great missing drug that was left behind. And this is lithium, essentially a naturally occurring element that is working to manage bipolar disorder that is useful for pretty much, let's say, several other mental disorders. And lithium is with us since a long time. That's an old presentation of 7-Up, the lithiated soda. So let's say since 19th centuries, we know that lithium can do things. It was banned in the 1940s, came back because it was shown that it was efficient in mania, came back on the market in North America in the 70s. We still don't know how it works. So what we're trying to do is to find clues for that. And lithium is essentially the poster child for all class of drugs that we call mood stabilizers. And mood stabilizers are what? They're drugs that prescribe for bipolar disorder that we don't know the hell how they work. It's pretty much how it is. So that's very hard with that to manage side effect. It's very hard to improve therapeutic window. It's very hard to improve anything if we don't know what we do. We only know it works. So to go at that, we started to look at the molecule that became, that came back over and over and over in the lithium field. So, and we tried to do better. So now it's the science part. Bear with me, I will try to make it palatable. So essentially, we know since the mid-1990s that one of the things lithium does is to inhibit a protein that we call GSK3, which is involved in zillions of things in the body. However, but inhibitors of GSK3, when given to a mouse, replicate the behavioral effect of lithium. However, lithium is not inhibiting GSK3 within its therapeutic window. You have to go higher. You have to go when it is toxic. So this is a problem. And what happened is that lithium is not only inhibiting GSK3, it's activating the other protein that regulates GSK3 and inactivates it. So not only you put the brake, you put the gas on the other brake. So you have a double hit on the same protein. We try to understand how this works in a mouse. And by doing so, we were interested in another protein named beta-arrestin, which is associated to receptors at the surface of the cell. And this beta-arrestin we showed was essential for the effect of lithium. So we made mice without the beta-arrestin. Lithium stopped regulating AKT and, AKT and GSK3. Lithium stopped working on the behavior. So we have a mouse that is resistant to lithium. Fine, we try to understand what's going on. And we found that AKT is deactivated by beta-arrestin because it forms this complex. And proteins love to do this type of thing, so essentially they form macromolecular machines that are serving a function, and then it could go and form a different machine that is serving another function in another part in the cell. But we found that this complex were existing, and we found that lithium was disassembling this complex. So now what we try to do is to see whether we can go farther with that. And the interesting part is that not only that, but this complex seems to sit at the crossroad of several genetic risk factors for schizophrenia and bipolar disorder. So essentially, you have here the D2, the beta-arrestin, the AKT. D2 and AKT are in a different color because they showed up in association study for schizophrenia. Serotonin receptors are regulating the same pathway. Pretty much everything from antidepressant to antipsychotics to lithium affect this pathway among the different things they do. And other genetic risk factors that were found, all in orange, all zero in this pathway. Not only that, what you have is that some of the targets of GSK3, such as genes involved in the regulation of circadian rhythms, are also on the pathway. So it looks like we have not a gene, not a protein, we have a pathway that we can drug. And the way we want to go at drugging this pathway is disrupting the interaction between AKT and beta-arrestin. And so we went back to our beta-arrestin, we looked at the structure, we analyzed how the interaction happened, and now what we can do is disrupt this interaction. We want to develop small compounds that develop this interaction that may not give us a drug that will be usable with human, but at least that will tell us whether this hypothesis of how lithium works is right or wrong. If it's right, bingo, we continue. If it's wrong, I'll write another grant. And I would like to thank you with this drawing and leave you with this drawing. This is a drawing from my friend Carlos Stella from Callao, Peru. It's the port of Lima. And Carlo is having a diagnosis of schizophrenia, and he's drawing and drawing and drawing, and he's drawing this world in which human and live at peace together and with animals, and most importantly with their monsters. And I don't know for you, but I would like sometimes to live in Carlo's world, and I'm sure if we work very hard together, maybe we can. Thank you.